talking with former drummer of the original Beatles, Pete Best, Bob Whitaker, whose book is called The Unseen Beatles, with all new photographs that he kept in a chicken coop for 20 years, and Jeffrey Giuliano, author of The Beatles Album and Blackbird and lots of other books on the Beatles, and an actor. And you say you know why Pete was fired.
You know, it's like, who killed Kennedy? No one knows for sure, but the supposition is that, you know, Pete's obviously a good-looking guy. They were very, very young at the time. You can't blame them for this. And Pete definitely got more, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
And this was just, you know, they were young kids.
Women, you're talking women,
I'm talking women. In fact, there's a film clip that exists, Pete knows about it, where the fans at the Cavern, where the Beatles played early on, were shouting, Ringo, Pete forever, Ringo never, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. He knows. I mean, the thing is, he was very popular. The women liked him. After the gig, they would crowd around Pete, and it was just, it niggled them. But they were young. Today, that wouldn't be a consideration. As a matter of fact, having a super good-looking drummer sitting at the back would be an asset.
It's what
you see?
Right.
But it was a little too much competition.
But it's silly. I mean, if that was the reason, okay. I mean, a lot of people, as Jeff turns around and says, they've lent over to that particular side. It was silly because, okay, the band was popular. Each member within the band was popular. So it's as long as the kids came and they screamed and they enjoyed themselves, you know, they were having fun.
Yeah.
And who they identified as their own personal heartthrob was entirely up to themselves.
The other nonsense was that he wasn't a good drummer. The other nonsense was that he was not a good drummer. Pete was a fantastic drummer.
That's the whole point.
He is a fantastic drummer.
Technicality is that somebody likes something better and you've all got to get on together and you know you're going to do it over a whole load of years. I mean, you know, sometimes one just doesn't fit in life and something else has got to happen. I mean, why try and even think that maybe Brian Epstein had something to do with it?
But he fired
I wouldn't have thought so, but who made that decision?
It wasn't Brian, it was the boys.
A lot of people have sort of turned around and said it may have been Brian.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, sort of tried to point the finger at it. But I always turn around and say it was a case of Brian was the hatchet guy.
And he
was the manager. They turn around and said, okay,
and don't
you do
forget
it.
That Brian Epstein of the Beatles story is the unsung hero
because
he certainly managed every single point of their performances, of their life, absolutely.
When we come back, we have to go to commercial. I want to find out if indeed what they were stereotyped as, like Ringo the crazy one, Paul the intellectual, John the intellectual, is this really true? We'll be back in a moment with more about the Beatles, so please stay with us. Signing my book, Still Talking, December 6th in New York, Rizzoli Books in the World Financial Trade Center, 12:30. And Saturday, December 7th in Los Angeles at the Bookstore and the Beverly Connection at 7:30. Okay, now we are back talking about the private side of the Beatles. Give me thumbnail sketches of each of them. It was John the Intellectual. You should know probably more than...
Well, I mean, I think that, yeah, I would say if you have to pin it down like that, he was. Paul, however, was the driving force between... concerning almost all of the major projects. Sgt. Pepper was his idea. The cover for Abbey Road, there were sketches that Paul did, and he would tell the photographer, Ian McMillan, what to do. Paul was very much the idea man. He was very much the guy who came up with the projects. In fact, John Lennon once complained that he'd get a call from Paul saying, listen, I've written 10 songs, let's do an album.
Right.
Well, what about mine, you know? Right. And he'd dash a couple off.
Okay, let me ask you, did you ever run into them?
No, last time I saw them.
Never, since the firing, never.
Played on the same bill as them twice.
Twice? Which,
yeah, within about 12 months. That was just when they were starting to get onto the pinnacle. You know, and they'd had chart success.
And did you talk? Did they come up to you? How you doing? What's up?
No, as close as we are now. That was support built to them. And we were coming off stage. They were going on stage. And we passed like ships in the night. And from that day to this, you know,
never apologized. You never said we're sorry.
No. I don't think that was... You know, that would be the Beatles, it wouldn't happen.
Last thing I would ask all of you, today, is there some group that comes even close to them?
Well, it ain't the New Kids on the Block, I'll tell you.
Yeah,
There is nothing.
Nothing.
Nothing that ever will come close to them. Their popularity, the love that they gave to people, well, nobody has got it. They don't even know what exists as far
as the
Beatles.
They were the Beatles Beethovens of our time.
Never be another phenomenon like them.
Nothing.
But popularity-wise, I think a group which is chasing them very fast in a different phenomenon is
U2. U2, but in a very different way.
In a different way.
But they were totally unique, and the people knew they were unique. So
yeah,
that's what makes
and it's also after a period of time of war, people losing discipline, opening up. You know, their music probably ruined every pop group in the world as far as performances are concerned, for the rest of their life.
Changed it all. Yeah. I thank you all so fascinating. Thank you. Now, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Very nice to meet you. Thank you both so much. Yeah. Pleasure to meet you. And we come back. My darling. We will be back with more gossip on Prince and Richard Gere. So this is some good show.